late, but it's not a problem. We just postpone everything. So we are happy to have Hugo for his second talk. Please.
Thank you very much. Okay, so just to recap from yesterday's lectures, there were three models that were defined. The POTS model, for which configurations are attribution to each vertices, to each vertex, sorry, of a spin, sigma ax. And then the probability of a configuration is proportional to exponential of minus beta times the energy. Then there was a second model, which was FK percolation, which was completely different. There, you would think of an attribution of 0 or 1 to the edges of your graph. And you think of this as a random subgraph of your original graph, where you keep the same vertices. And for the edges, you only keep the edges for which omega e is equal to 1. And then there was the six-vertex model, which is a model of random attribution of orientation to every edge. And these orientations, they all need to satisfy the ice rule, and then you have a probability of a configuration which is proportional to a certain weight, which is A1 to the number of vertices of first type, A2 to the number of vertices of second type, et cetera, et cetera. Today, what I want to be explaining is the connection between these two models. Okay? So this is going to be the subject of today's talk, and tomorrow we will see the connection between these two models. Okay? So, second part of the course, so from POTS to FK, and this is known as the Edwards-Sokal copy. Okay. So, in order to define the Edwards-Sokal coupling, I will first define an operation which I'm going to call coloring of a graph. Okay, so the coloring operation. And it goes as follows. You pick a graph, and this graph, I'm going to think of it as omega, okay? So you pick a subgraph of G with same set of vertices and a subset of edges. And what you do is that for every connected component of the graph, you pick a color. You pick, so let's call it C, this connected component. Pick sigma C in TQ. So let me maybe make a drawing. So let's say my original graph is this. This is G. Let's say the graph omega is this graph. Like that. So remember, it has always the same set of vertices, it's just a set of edges that changes. So what I do is that for every connected component, I choose a spin. Okay, so let's say this is component C1, C2, C3, and C4. I choose sigma C1, sigma C2, sigma C3, sigma C4. But I'm going to do this in a peculiar way, which is that I'm going to choose this uniformly at random, independently for every connected component. So, uniformly among TQ and independently for every connected component. So when you are with Q equal 2, just means you toss a coin for every connected component. If it's tail, you put plus 1. If it's face, you put minus 1. And you do this independently for every. You resample your, you retoss for every connected component. And then the last thing is that for any x in V, so for every vertex of your graph, you just set sigma x to be equal to sigma c, where c is a connected component containing x. So what I do is I'm simply setting all the spins in the connected component to be equal to this variable containing x. Okay, so by construction, every vertex which is in one connected component receives the same spin. Okay, and by construction, if I start from a graph omega, I end up with a spin configuration sigma. Okay, but now what is interesting and what is the subject of the theorem is that if you fix q an integer large or equal to 2, and p, a parameter between 0 and 1, if omega is sampled according to fk percolation with parameter p and q, so if I just take also omega at random, then sigma is sampled according to mu g beta, where beta is equal to minus q minus 1 over q log, log 1 minus p. So if I start from a fk percolation configuration and I do the coloring operation, I end up with a POTS model at a certain inverse temperature, and this inverse temperature is easily expressible in terms of the original parameters of my model, which is its p. So of course, it's always, I mean, it's a link only when q is an integer. So really here we think of q an integer, but you are gonna see it's a very useful link. Maybe before telling you about the proof, let me give you one application of this link. So when you create a link between two models, you want it to be a nice dictionary between the properties of one model and the properties of the other one. So let me illustrate that by the following. So if you look at the POTS model, typically the type of quantity you would be interested in are the spin-spin correlations. You want to know how much two vertices, I mean the spins of two vertices, have a tendency to align. So typically, you would like, for instance, to be looking at this type of things. What is the correlation between the spin at x and the spin at y? Okay? And what I claim is that this gets very nicely rewritten in terms of properties of fk percolation. And in addition, maybe you forgot, but yesterday I briefly mentioned that the properties that we are interested in percolation, in fk percolation, are the connectivity properties of my graph, where the points are connected to each other, whether there is a path from the top to the bottom of my stone, if we think again to the physical system behind it. Well, here you are gonna see it's gonna be expressed in terms of the simplest property you can imagine with x and y, which is the probability that they are connected, that they are in the same connected component. So this is actually probability of x connected to y. And here the only thing that I need to be careful is if, of course, I mean, if beta is indeed minus q minus 1 over q log 1 minus p. So you can express the spin-spin correlations are connectivity properties of your graph. This, by the way, is sometimes referred to as a graphical representation of a spin system. Why? Because I'm rewriting correlations in terms of graphical properties of a model.
here the fact that there is a connection between X and Y.
Okay. Well, let's try to prove this, and you are going to see it's not difficult once you have the theorem. So what do you do? Let's construct, I mean, you see here, I did something a little bit strange. I started from a probability space in which just omega is defined, fk percolation is defined. And what I did is that I enhanced this by adding some randomness, which is the possibility of choosing uniformly the sigma. And then in this big probability space where I have both percolation and these random choices of the sigma c, I am able to find, if you want, Pott's model. So let me define, so consider, I'm going to write it in another color to be certain to P to be just the law on this big probability space that contains both percolation and the random choices. So consider P the law of omega and the sigma c, the random choices. Okay? And now let's look at this quantity. So this quantity in this big probability space, I can rewrite it as just the expectation, the average if you want, of sigma x scalar sigma y, because sigma is defined in this big probability space. Okay? But in this big probability space, omega is also defined. So what I can do is I can decide to decompose this quantity into whether x is connected to y or x is not connected to y. So I can write this, I can split this in two terms by linearity if you want. I can write this as indicator that x is connected to y, and here just to be certain to that we are speaking of the right thing, I'm going to put an omega just to highlight the fact that it's x connected to y in omega, plus the same term, sigma x scalar sigma y, but indicator that x is not connected to y in omega. Right? By linearity, this plus this is equal to 1, so I recover exactly what is on the top. But now, notice that things look very good. Why? If x is connected to y, in the random color, in the coloring procedure, what does it force? It forces the spin at x and the spin at y to be equal. So this thing is actually nothing else but 1 when x is connected to y. On the other hand, when x is not connected to y, what did I say? I said that I'm choosing the spins independently for the two things. And here it's easy to see that if you fix the spin of the first cluster and you average on the possibilities for the second cluster, you get an average which is 0. So here, I could write it if you prefer, I mean, I can, this is not exactly equal to 0, but the conditional expectation of this condition on omega is equal to 0. So this whole term here must be 0. The spins are attributed at random, so by the fact that it's centered, in some sense, it gives you 0. So what do you end up with? You end up with expectation of x connected to y in omega, I mean, indicator of x connected to y, and this is exactly what is actually defined as the probability that x is connected to y, because in our procedure, we sample omega with the law p of GPQ. Okay? So that's how you get this result, and you see it's very straightforward once you have the theorem. So from now on, I'm going to focus on the theorem. You are going to see it's not a very difficult theorem to prove. I mean, of course, one has always to be a little bit careful. It's not a very difficult theorem to prove when you are a probabilist, in the sense that you are used to this probability and things like that. It's maybe going to be a little bit tougher if you didn't work too much with probabilities. Actually, this argument is maybe not that simple if you didn't work with probability. But, okay, I'm going to try to sketch all the arguments and then you can come at the end if you want to have more details. So let's prove the theorem.
So, I'm going to, in fact, in order to prove the theorem, I'm going to kind of tell you exactly what this P is, in fact. So I'm going to define a probability measure which I call P. I'm going to put it in blue because it's the same as the one there. On pairs omega sigma, okay? Where omega is an element of 0, 1 to the e, and sigma is an element of tq to the p. Okay, so I'm going to define this probability, and I'm going to define it as follows. So I'm going to say, so first thing, say that, so for now it's not that clear that this corresponds to the measure there. It's going to be clear at the end in some sense, okay? So say that omega and sigma are compatible if the following occurs. If omega xy equal 1 implies sigma x equals sigma y. Okay, so omega and sigma are compatible if I have this property for every xy. So for every xy in E. By the way, sorry, I'm gonna do like that. Okay, so I say that it's compatible, and now I define P. I'm gonna say that P of a pair omega sigma, it's equal to 1 over a partition function, and actually this partition function is going to be GPQ. And I'm going to write P to the omega, 1 minus P to the E minus omega, indicator that omega sigma is compatible. Okay, that's my measure. It's a weird measure, but I want to be saying two things. I want to be saying that, in fact, it is this measure. And I want to be saying that if I only look at sigma, I end up with the law of the Potts model. So in order to see that this corresponds to the measure there, what you can do is the following. I'm going to just decompose this in two steps, and you are going to see it's going to be transparent that it gives you the right thing. So omega sigma, I'm going to write it like that. 1 over z fk gpq p to the omega 1 minus p to the e minus omega q to the k of omega. That's the first term I'm going to put. I just introduce Q to the number of cluster of connected components. And I'm just going to add 1 over Q to the K of omega, indicator that omega and sigma compatible. I did nothing. I just added and subtracted, multiplied and divided by the same quantity, Q to the number of connected components. But when I write it like that, things become a little bit more apparent because this is just the probability to have omega. And this, if you think about it, it's exactly choosing among, for every connected component, choosing among q possible values. Well, that's exactly the probability to exactly fall on the right sigma c for each of the connected components. Sorry. So this is exactly corresponding to the probability of, I'm going to write it like this, of finding sigma by using the coloring operation. Right? If omega and sigma are not compatible, if sigma is not compatible with omega, there is no chance of finding sigma if I have omega and I sample the coloring operation, and I do the coloring operation. And on the other hand, if it's compatible, then in order to actually find sigma from omega, I need for each connected component of omega to exactly fall on the right spin to get actually the sigma. So I have exactly a probability 1 over q to the number of connected components of doing so. So this is an argument. We don't see the blue. So anyway. So this is an argument. I mean, I could, of course, write it much more formally, but I think it will not make the thing more transparent. It's an argument to say that this P actually corresponds to the procedure we mentioned, which is first sampling omega according to FK percolation and then using the coloring operation. Okay, now what I need to do is to try to guess what is the law of sigma, what is the probability of finding one sigma out of this. But you are going to see it's not that difficult to do. If I want to have the law of sigma, what I need to do is the probability of sigma is just the sum of all the possible omega of the probability of omega sigma. Right? So probability of finding sigma is the sum of all omega of the probability of finding omega sigma. Okay, so here we are going to be very pedestrian and we are going to look at this sum. So in order to kind of decompose nicely this sum, what I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce the following. So define E of sigma. So let me just check in which order I do it just to be coherent. So E of sigma is going to be the set of edges, x, y, such that sigma x is not equal to sigma y. Okay? Okay. And now what I'm going to do is that for sigma x not equal to sigma y, what do I know necessarily for the omegas here? The omega for which this is strictly positive, they must be compatible with sigma. There is no choice. But if they are compatible with sigma, if sigma x is not equal to sigma y, we know for a fact that omega of xy must be equal to zero. Otherwise, it would not be compatible. So already when I write this, so I can say sum of omega compatible with sigma of probability, or let me drop the blue because it's DAing me too much. And for these guys, I know already that for every edge in E of sigma, omega must be closed. So if I look at the definition upstairs, I know that all the E in E of sigma must contribute to the 1 minus P. So I must have 1 minus P to the E of sigma. I still have the Z, of course, of FK GPQ. And then, on the other hand, for edges that are not in E of sigma, then the compatibility tells me nothing about whether I'm open or closed, so I can write it as a sum for, I'm going to call it omega prime, in 0, 1 to the E minus E of sigma, and here P to the omega prime, 1 minus P to the E minus E of sigma minus omega prime. This is just a way, if you think about it, here I just rewrote exactly the sum upstairs. I mean, the quantity upstairs, sums of compatible guys, by just removing the part which is forced to be zero. Okay? But now here, you are summing over every omega prime in this thing, this quantity. What is it equal to? It's simply equal to 1 for every edge.
the edge is either open or closed. So, I mean, there will be an omega prime for which this edge is open. It will contribute p times something. And there will be an omega prime for which it's closed. It will contribute 1 minus p times the same thing. P plus 1 minus p equal 1. That's going to be the go-home message for today. And this thing is therefore equal to 1. So, at the end, the probability of sigma is equal to 1 minus p to the e of sigma divided by z fk gpq. And now I just have to set, I mean, to use what p is equal to. So this is, if I rewrite, it's equal to exponential of minus beta q over q minus 1 e of sigma over z. We are almost there, because now what is the only thing I would need to prove? I would need to prove that this thing here is actually, maybe up to a constant, equal to the Hamiltonian of the Potts model. So let's try to do that. And we will be done with the proof. I let you think about it while I clean the board. Okay. So recall that hg of sigma, it's minus the sum of sigma x, sigma y for x, y, an edge. Right? And TQ was exactly defined in such a way that if x is equal to y, sigma y is of course equal to 1. And that if x is not equal to 1, sigma x, sigma y is equal to minus 1 over q minus 1. So this thing I can just, this quantity is going to contribute 1 if you are not in E of sigma, and it's going to contribute minus 1 over q minus 1 if you are in E of sigma. So it's going to be minus the cardinality of E minus E of sigma plus, I mean, minus times minus 1 over Q minus 1, so plus 1 over Q minus 1 times the cardinality of E of sigma, and here you realize that you end up with minus E plus Q over Q minus 1 E of sigma. So overall, what you ended up with here that this is equal to exponential. So there is going to be a beta times E divided by Z Fk of GPQ. This is a constant that depends on nothing, times exponential of minus beta Hg of sigma. So this is exactly what we wanted, and we conclude the proof. I mean, I wanted to give you a full proof of that because at the end it's not a complicated proof, even though maybe it requires some thinking, especially if you are not versed in probability, but there is nothing deep behind it, and you have a full argument. By the way, it tells you something which was maybe not that clear at the beginning, and I'm bouncing on that because yesterday a question was asked after the talk on whether the connections I will mention can relate also, I mean, can translate the free energy of one system into the free energy of another one. Notice that just a byproduct of this connection is that there is an equality between the normalizing constants. So exponential of beta times E divided by Z Fk of GPQ is equal to 1 over Z Potts of g beta. So if you want to go to the free energy quantity, you can actually relate the free energy of the two systems. So if you can compute it for one system, you have it for the other one. That's for people who love free energies, which should be all of you. Everybody should love free energies. Okay. That's the Edwards-Sokal coupling. I must say it's maybe a little bit poorly named because it's actually already kind of present in the original paper of Fortune and Castellan, but Edwards and Sokal really made a good use of this and generalized this to other systems. So that's why it's often
denoted like that.
Okay, before I go to a deeper application of this, this thing, let me just mention a variation around this. Which is when I take wired boundary conditions. So I'm not going to rewrite everything and reprove everything, but let me mention that there is also a link when you look at tau boundary condition and one boundary condition. So there is a notion of wired coloring operation. Is the same, except one thing, which is that you color all the connected components. The rest of the world cannot hear me anymore. It's the time to do the show that I wanted. Sorry? Perfect, good. Okay, so the wired coloring operation is the same as the coloring operation, except that all the connected components that intersect the boundary, they all receive the same spin, which is tau. So you don't sample them at random, except clusters, connected components. Intersecting the boundary receive spin tau, and then the theorem, if P and beta are chosen exactly like for the previous theorem, so if you choose them properly, then if omega is sampled according to P1 GPQ, then sigma is sampled according to mu G beta tau. Okay, and I'm pretty sure you can believe me on this one. We are not going to prove it, that if you proceed in the same way as you did for the free boundary conditions, you end up with this. Why did I mention this? I told you I wanted to mention this thing, this tau boundary condition, because it's going to become natural at some stage. Here is the stage where it's natural, which is that if I translate, before I could relate the spin-spin correlation to connectivity properties. Well, in fact, when you look at the POTS model, there is a very, very natural quantity to look at, which is to look at whether a spin aligns with the boundary condition. You will see it's going to give me the magnetization of the system in a minute when I will pass to the infinite volume. And this quantity, if you think about it, and you look at this coloring operation and you redo this kind of trick of decomposing on whether X is connected to the boundary or not, you will end up that this is a probability with the following quantity, the probability that X is connected to the boundary. Okay? And you are going to see now for the application, it's what I'm going to use. Okay, so an important application now. And I hope that this is going to illustrate, I'm going to tell you one application. I gave you one application, but this is a tiny one. I'm going to give you a true application of this Edward Sokal coupling. But this is one out of hundreds. There is a whole community working for like 30 years on playing with, you know, jumping on the right model to prove a certain thing and so on. And if Edward Sokal coupling was not existing, I would probably not be in front of you to tell you, well, obviously not to tell you about it, but probably to tell you anything at all. Okay, so, for instance, it's my daily bread. So, an important application. And I think I chose this one because I think it's a good thing anyway, if you stop completely being interested in this, or you were never interested in this, this is at least one nice result, which is a computation of the critical point
of the POTS model. On Z2. So it's a very, very classical result in the case of the easing model, which goes back to Onzager. And for the POTS model, it's a more recent result that you can compute the critical point. So what is the critical point and what is its value? So yesterday there was a question related to this. Will the fact that I don't use, I don't count multiplicity for the boundary be a problem or not? Not really, because now what I'm going to do is what I should maybe have done at the beginning, which is I'm going to pass to the infinite lattice. Okay, so I don't want to be spending 10 minutes, detailing you how I do that. I'm going to be very lazy. I'm a mathematician. I'm allowed to do that. I'm going to use precompactness. Okay, the set of measure is precompact. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a subsequential limit of P, this coupling between this probability measure on this space where both FK percolation and POTS exist, and I should tell you the subsequential limit as G tends to Z2. Okay? So it's not clear that it converges. In fact, it does. And it's not super complicated to prove, but it will take too long in this talk. So I'm not even going to justify it converges. I'm going to extract a subsequential limit. And now I have, so let me maybe say this was just for this. Let's call it PG, just to highlight the dependency in G. And out of this subsequential limit, I end up with a measure, which I'm going to call PZ2, which is an infinite volume measure. And a good thing out of this is that in PZ2, there will be both the configuration omega on Z2, in 0, 1 to Z2, and there will be a sigma in TQ to the Z2. So here it's the edges of Z2. And by the way, I was a little bit, okay. I should say I'm taking the limit of this, the coupling for this thing. So let me call it P1. Okay? So I'm not taking the limit for free boundary condition. I'm taking the limit for a wired boundary condition. So I have both an omega on the percolation configuration on the whole space, on the whole lattice, and I have the spin configuration on the whole lattice. Okay? So omega, I'm going to denote its law by PZ2 PQ1, and sigma its law by mu Z2 beta tau. Okay? I'm just setting a name for their law. And by the way, if you don't like the coupling, you can also think, if I would start with P1 GPQ, I could take G to infinity and I will end up with a P1 Z2 PQ. And if I take the POTS model on finite graph G and I take the limit when G tends to Z2, I would end up with this law. Okay? Now, let me define the magnetization of the POTS model to be the quantity M of beta Q, which is just mu Z2 Q tau of sigma zero tau. So it's exactly this quantity, but for the infinite volume measure. It's called the magnetization. It is actually interpreted as a magnetization because the POTS model is a model for ferromagnetism. In the case of the easing model, it has a very clean interpretation in terms of magnets and things like that. So this is the magnetization. And I'm going to define the critical point of the system, beta C, to be the infimum of the beta for which the magnetization is strictly positive. Okay? By the way, if you work a little bit, which we will not even need in order to prove that beta c is equal to what it is. If you work a little bit, you can also prove that it's the supremum of the beta for which it's zero. In fact, this magnetization is increasing with beta. I mean, is non-decreasing with beta. Okay? So this is called the critical point. And my goal is to try to give you a hint at its computation. I will not have time to finish today, but I don't even know when I started. So was it 30?
You have about 5 minutes.
Sir. Okay, good. So I'm just going to state the result, and then we will actually do the whole proof tomorrow. I need to be careful to have time to tell you about the Baxter-Wu connection, but. So the critical point is an interesting quantity to look at because that's the, I mean, it's the point where a phase transition occurs in my system. So I would like to be computing it. And what I claim is that on the square lattice, this is doable. And this magnetization, and this critical point is equal to the following. The theorem. It's a theorem from 2012 by Vincent Befara and myself. And it says that for Q larger or equal to 2, beta C, I should have maybe said that it depends on Q a priori, beta C is equal to Q minus 1 over Q log of 1 plus square root Q. So a fairly simple expression. And I should say right away that you may have seen another expression for that, which is 1/2 of log of 1 plus square root Q. It's because sometimes a Potts model is not defined with this set TQ, but just the spins are just in the set 1, 2 to Q, and you define the Hamiltonian a little bit differently, but it's the same result. It's exactly the same result. I mean, you translate one into the other one very easily. And so just to mention that for Q equal 2, which is the Ising model, it gives you beta C equal 1/2 of log of 1 plus square root 2, and this is a classical result by Onzager from 44. I mean, of course, I mean, one has to be careful. I mean, it was not really proved in Onzager 44, but I mean, in all these works and all the corollaries of it, you end up with this quantity. So, very classical result for Q equal 2, much newer result for Q generic. And one of the reasons for this is that the Ising model on many aspects is nicer than the Potts model. First, it's more integrable, for people who know what integrability means. And second, just even to guess this quantity, because, I mean, why would you end up with this? For the Ising model, you have a duality, which is called the Kramers-Vanier duality. So from Kramers-Vanier duality, which I'm not going to tell you what it is, one may guess beta C for Q equal 2. Okay, so this is very good, but this Kramers-Vanier duality doesn't hold at all for Potts model. At least we don't know how to end up with a duality for the Potts model. And so what I'm going to explain, okay, I'm going to take the 2 minutes to tell you about, just for people who don't come back tomorrow, tell you about the FK percolation booster that you get for larger values of Q, which is that why the Potts model directly doesn't have a duality for Q larger than 2 strictly. FK percolation does for every Q. There is a notion of duality which is very natural for FK percolation and it holds for every Q. And this is going to allow us to guess that the critical point of FK percolation will be equal to a certain thing and that will translate into the result for the Potts model. So let me just in 1 minute tell you about the statement for the duality, and tomorrow I will prove it and sketch the corollary for the POTS model. So imagine you fix G. So fix G subset of Z2 and define a dual graph G star, which is as follows. So you have your square lattice, and for every edge of the square lattice, let's call it E, I'm going to define a dual edge, E star, which is going to be connecting the centers of the faces which are bordered by E. So it's just an edge that is, I mean, it's an edge, so E star is an edge of, if you want, one half plus Z2, just a translated version of Z2, that is crossing, is Z edge, that is crossing E in its middle. Okay, so this is E star. And now I'm going to, so G star is going to be the graph I will be done there, okay? I promise I'm not going there. If I'm going there, you can just, well, I don't know what you can do, but. So I'm going to define, so I didn't tell you what G star is. So E star, so set of edges of G star is going to be the set of E star for E in E. So I'm just taking all the dual edges for the edges of the original graph. And V star, it's the endpoints of edges in E star. So if I just make one drawing, I need to be very careful not to go there. I promise something, so I'm going to write smaller and smaller when I'm going to get this. Don't be too upset. So, for instance, this would be, the yellow would be the dual graph of the white one. I took all the dual things, okay? And now, for omega sample according to, I mean, for omega configuration on E, I'm going to define omega star, the configuration on E star, by setting omega star of E star is equal to 1 minus omega. So what I'm kind of saying is that if I have an edge in the original, if I have an edge in the original graph, which is open, which has variable 1, this edge will have variable 0, and vice versa. And theorem, it's the last sentence. If omega, anyway, I'm getting there, right? If omega is sample according to P, G, PQ, then omega star is sample to P, 1, G star, P star, Q star, where it's still a sentence, Q star equal Q, and P, P star times 1 minus P, 1 minus P star is equal to Q. So if you take omega according to FK percolation, omega star is also going to be something that looks like FK percolation. And tomorrow we are going to use this to try to guess what is this thing. And you can try already to guess with this relation PP star over 1 minus P, 1 minus P star equal Q, and the relation between beta and Q, beta and P, why you should end up with this quantity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a very, very nice talk. So, are there questions? Maybe okay, go ahead. Maybe here's a question there.
Just to be sure, all what you said is valid for a generic graph except that theorem in which you are assuming that the graph is a square lattice?
This is a square lattice. This is a... So, Anyway, in this class, I always looked at subgraph of the square lattice, and when I take the limit, I look at Z.
Okay, but everything else is valid, is generic.
The Edward Sokal cupping is valid for generic graphs that don't even need to be planar.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, you are right. And you don't even need to take nearest neighbor models.
Is there a problem with math? Yeah. Just move your line here. Thank you.
Sorry. I think I kid like 20 right. people.
Okay.
Yes, so it's valid in full generality, and you can actually also do this critical point for other graph using this type of connection.
Yeah. There is one more question here.
You were hoping for zero questions.
Sorry, it's just a detail. So in the last theorem that you presented, omega is sampled according to P1 GPQ or really P?
No, P. P. Yes.
Okay.
You go from zero boundary condition to one boundary condition. Okay. I mean, from free boundary condition to one boundary condition.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's not exactly self-dual.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
I will restate this tomorrow, but I wanted this for people that don't come tomorrow to at least see that there is something good about FK percolation.
Okay, so are there questions online, maybe? No question online? So if there are no more questions, let's thank Hugo once again.
Thank you very much.
And we'll continue very soon.